I bet you can't guess what this video is about. Well, I'm filming this in March, during the lockdown period. This is for those viewers in the future. But I did manage to get myself out. I took advantage of what our Prime Minister said. He said it's important to get your exercise every day and to go out for a nice bike ride. But I did film some of the bike ride, so I'll put that in a minute for you. But this is again more Stoveholic video about the Svea 123R. On my previous video, I got some very helpful comments from people telling me on different ways of lighting the stove, and a couple of the comments made a lot of sense to me. So I thought I would try and light the stove using the method and technique that they described. And also something that I've learnt about the stove as well. And I found that if you put it on a cold metal base, the canister, the actual reservoir doesn't pressurise as much. And therefore the stove doesn't really get going to to its full potential. There is the risk with this type of stove that it can go into like a thermal runaway. So you don't want, I'm aware of all the pros and cons to this stove now, I've done a lot of reading and research on it. You don't want to insulate it too much, and you don't want a windshield around it and close to it, because it does need ventilation to maintain its sort of equilibrium, if you like. But let's move the paraphernalia of tea making away. And what was told to me was that you you dribble the priming fluid, in this case it's denatured alcohol, methylated spirits, dribble it down. Don't bother, I'm jumping the gun. Get a grip, boy. We are going to remove the windscreen. I'm going to just crack the fuel opening. Oh, crack it, take it off. That's equalised the pressure in the reservoir to the atmospheric pressure that's outside, normal atmospheric pressure. So it's all equalised now. Put the windshield back on. Windscreen's back on. Put the key, which operates the valve, through the large slot. And leave it there for now. Then pour the priming methylated spirits down the top of the burner. And what happens is that it runs down the burner, down the stem, and it collects in the bowl, which is an indent in the actual fuel reservoir itself. That's now run down, and I can see down in the bowl underneath that there's a full reservoir of methylated spirits. And what I've got here is a stick. This works well for me, and I've got a little bit of meths in there, because if this was cold, I know from experience that meths doesn't like to ignite when it's cold. So I always, when I'm out camping with my meth stoves, I get a twig or some grass and I soak it in meths like that, and then stick it in the stove and stir it. So what I'm going to do is just light this, put it into the priming bowl, and just move it around to get everything warmed up. And then what will happen, as the flames will go up, they'll warm up the vaporizer tube and the stove will start to pressurize. Yeah, look at that light. lighting. I can manipulate that flame, because if it was a cold stove, I just know it wouldn't light. But now that's lit, lovely. Now what's happening now, that's now pressurising. You've got to have a lot of air. You know, you don't fill the tank up on this stove. You want it about three quarters full. And the air heats and it expands, and that's what pressurises the fuel, the white gas. This is proper stoveaholicanism, isn't it? And now that's burnt all its priming up. So, is it hot enough? Yes. It's gone straight to a blue flame. So at the moment, the fuel tank is not at all warm, so there's not a lot of pressure built up, but because it's on this sort of wooden type base, it will actually develop a lot more warmth and accelerate itself, and before you know it, it'll be a roaring flame. Listen to the silence, isn't that wonderful? So thanks for those people that sent me that information about lighting the stove. It works a treat. So I'm going to enjoy my brew now, and then whilst I drink my tea, I'll put the little clip in where I went out for my daily exercise. And it'll give some of you that are locked in at the moment access to some nature, I suppose, albeit through the screen of a computer. And me and Elsa here will enjoy our tea and biscuits. And then when I bring you back, I'm actually in my workshop at the moment, when I bring you back, I'll show you another petrol stove that I've got. This is part of my permitted exercise. I go out on my bike, do a few miles, get the old heart pumping and the lungs working. Oh yeah. Right, here we are. This is a bridle way type path, which takes us into Stanton Park, which is a nice bit of woodland. This was really, it's really bumpy. It was so muddy here, it was impossible to cycle a few weeks ago, but the ground's dried up nicely. As you can see, I'm now able to cycle along it quite easily. I come this way quite a lot on the push bike. It's really nice. I'm wearing, I've got one back the front. I'm wearing mittens. These are flying mittens actually. I'm not gonna take them off. I'm not gonna touch anything.
no risk of picking up an infection from anybody or me transmitting anything to anyone either. Right, here we are. This ancient track, this is the Kingsdown Lane. That way goes all the way up to Blunsdon, about a mile and a half, 2 miles away. That way there goes to Vickers. Let's change these gloves round in the wrong hands. That's better. OZ flying gloves. Not been up in the paramotor for 5 or 6 weeks now. Paramotor Club has decided not to fly during the lockdown period, and we recognise that it's a high risk activity, and the last thing we want to do as a club is to put any additional strain or pressure upon the NHS at the moment. So Stanton Park there, this is the main sort of path through. It was once upon a time a railway line. Anyway, let's cycle along it. It leads to a very nice nice woodland on my right, the Great Wood in Stanton, and a nice lake further on in. Well, just look at this. This is very sad. The scene of devastation. This used to be a shed which belonged to a beekeeper called Ron Hoskins. It's a lifetime's work. You can see his apiary of all the hives and nuclei hives he's got over there. Ron was working on a strain of bee which was more resilient to the Varroa Jacobsoni mite, which was decimating bee populations. Unfortunately, in recent weeks, some youths decided to burn his shed down and more or less destroy a lot of Ron's work. I can't quite say a lifetime, but the chap Ron, he was he's an elderly chap. He's in his late 80s now, and I don't know if he's going to come back from this, to be honest with you. Anyway, let's move on to happier things. Remember, earlier on in the bike ride I mentioned about the lake. Here's the lake. Fishing platform down there. This is a dam. All this area along here is a dam. And there's the lake, an ornamental lake. There is a folly, I'll go to the folly in a minute, over in that area. The folly was built as a kind of posh garden ornament for the people that lived in the big house. The big house is over that way, you can't see it at the moment. Duck come in thinking they got some bread. Just along here is the outflow to the dam. There's the outflow. Just coming up now on my right is the folly. So there's the folly, and if you turn 180 degrees in the distance there, you can see the big house. Let's have a closer look at the folly. It's meant to looked like a ruin, part of a ruin. But it is quite modern, mid 20th century, I think. Just along here, there's a lovely yew tree. It's possibly the oldest tree in this wood. Most of the trees probably 200-400 years old, but this yew is quite significant in my opinion because it's located on top of a mound, which makes it interesting because this would have been probably in the day, well, still is today, quite a damp area. So this mound would have meant this area was dry, and perhaps this is a piece of go back to earlier times maybe. There's the yew tree, and you can see the ground rises up with the yew tree in the middle. I wonder if there was something of significance here in the past. Lovely big old tree that. Here's an area of the woodland that's been cleared. There are a few tall trees that they felled, and they've cut the brush up to make these little fences, I suppose you'd call them. And there's new trees and been planted in there. Just quite a nice piece of open woodland within a denser patch of woodland. Very nice.
There you go. I hope you enjoyed the bike ride, and I hope you're all bearing up under the strain of this lockdown and adhering to the advice that the government has issued. I think it's important at the moment to follow their guidelines on this. Here's the other stuff. This is the single burner Coleman 533 Sportster stove. It's a bit dusty. It's covered in dust. I've fueled the stove up now. I put a bit of fuel in there. You can see a comparison in the size. The little Svea 123 is a lot smaller and more compact than the Coleman stove. This is the second one I've had of these. The first one, the pump failed on it, the generator clogged up, and I just think it's built to a price, whereas this is built to a standard. So I'm not overly that much of a fan on it. It's still an iconic stove. More moving parts, things to go wrong, whereas with the Svea there's not so much to go wrong. Let's move the Svea out of the way. This is more for car camping or for base camping. It's not the sort of thing you would pack in a backpack. It's a picnic stove or a car camping stove. It's a lot bigger. And I made a trivet to go with it. And it's sized especially for this stove, so if I want to put a heavyweight pan on this, I can now, because I can put that on there like that, and then the trivet takes the weight, and the burner itself doesn't take the weight, so now I can really have a very big heavy pot on there and not put the stove under any weight onto its burner, or any chance of the pot toppling off a larger area. But this stove, to ignite it, needs pumping. So you've got a pump on the side you pull out. I think about 20 pumps. Again, there's plenty of instructions on the internet about how to run this stove, so I'm not going to go into details about that, but I'm not overly that fond of it. I am going to prime it. You don't need to prime it. I've ignited it many times without priming, but I thought I've got some mess here. Let's just light the thing up. It'll make it easier. It'll pre-warm the generator. Pipe going across the top is a generator. Basically, it turns the fuel into gas. So that's it. The stove is now it's not even that. It's not quite running properly. It hasn't been run for some time. For some reason it's not burning around one side of the burners. Only half the burners are light. There we go, something's happening now. It's thinking about it. There we are, it's now, the stove is now running fine. Gotcha. Oh, there we are. Still got some biscuits to me now for the finish off. She does like her biscuits. She's doing very well. She was supposed to go in for surgery on Thursday, just gone, but it was cancelled. But she seems to be fine. She's an old dog. Her time will come one day, but she's happy at the moment. And that's all that counts. Anyway, these videos are really just a little bit of light entertainment for you, because I know there's some of us that are locked down in apartments or in London or in urban places, and you can't get out. So this brings a little bit of light entertainment to make this time a bit more pleasant for somebody, I hope. So that's the second video on the stoves. I've got another petrol stove. It's a Coleman twin burner. I don't think I'll show that one. I might show it maybe in the next video. So I've got three petrol stoves now, all told. The little Svea, the 533 Coleman, and the big twin burner Coleman stove. This, of course, is the gem. I love it. In the next episode of the Stoveholic, we might be looking at... might get an old paraffin stove out, actually. And then there's the good old faithful reliable Meths burners. And then I've got a couple of solid fuel stoves as well. So they'll be coming up in subsequent episodes. And then, of course, we can then continue on the theme of this light-hearted entertainment by looking at becoming a potaholic and a lampaholic. Anyway, thanks for watching, and I'll see you in the next video. And keep on keeping on. Cheers. What do you want?
When's your dinner?
Go away, you're not allowed.
Oh, we're here.
You're not allowed in here. Go away.